Can everybody hear me? Y'all's job, y'all's assignment for Sunday morning. I need to read off the list of officers. See if anybody wants, everybody wants to keep. Listen to me. Everybody wants to keep their current positions, and if the Lord's laid on your heart to take a new position. Anyway, we need to read those off. We do have maybe a few openings here and there, I think. Let's look tonight to John chapter 1. I think last week we got down through verse number 18. And we're going to talk a little bit more. We've talked about him a little bit. I think back in verse 6, who we know of as John the Baptist, or as some describe him, John the Baptizer. So let's read, starting in verse 19, let's read down through verse 34. We probably won't get that far, but let's read verses 19 through 34 of John chapter 1. And this is the record of John, and it's talking about John the Baptist. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who art thou?" And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." In other words, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Art thou Elijah?" And he saith, "I am not." "Art thou that prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then said they unto him, "Who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself?" He said, "I am the voice of the one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as said the prophet Isaiah." And they which were sent were of the Pharisees. And they asked him and said unto him, "Why baptizest thou then, if thou be not Christ, nor Elijah, neither that prophet?" John answered them, saying, "I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you, whom you know not. He it is who, coming after me, is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unloose. These things were done in Bethabara, beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me.' And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bare record, saying, 'I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, Upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God." So if you look back with me to verse 19, the record of John the Baptist. I wonder what the record of Marty Mosley would be. What's your record going to be? J. Vernon McGee says this: "This is the first incident in the life of John the Baptist which John gives us in his gospel record." So this is the first incident in the life of John the Baptist which the Apostle John gives us in the gospel record. He does not give us the story of the beginning of this man. We find that in the Gospel of Luke, where Zacharias was doing the priestly duty, and Gabriel, the angel, came and told him that Elizabeth was going to give birth to a son, and they should call him named John. But we don't find that in the book of John. We find that in the book of Luke. And they came and asked him, "Who art thou?" We talked Sunday about job interviews. And most every job interview I've ever sat in on, whether I was being interviewed or interviewing, tell me about yourself. And there are those that say that you can't take your Christianity on the job. Change jobs. Change jobs. Somebody came up to me one day and said, this was when I was at Cloverdale, said, "Are children allowed to pray here?" And I think part of what I told her was this: as long as there's tests in school, prayers will be going up. Sometimes mine was this: "Lord, I forgot to study. Help me. Help me remember what they said. Help me." So they came to him, verse 19, "Who are you?" Would our answer include anything about Jesus? It should. If we're one of his, it should be included in who we are, because without him, we wouldn't be who we are. Without him, we wouldn't be where we are, and we could go on and on and on and on and on about what all he's done for us. And I, for one, I just have to confess, I'm not thankful enough. I am not thankful enough. So, John, who are you? Tell us about yourself. And verse 20 says, he confessed. Would we? One group writer says, too often institutional religion is suspicious and opposed to the unusual. If a person is different or does things differently, he's questioned. If a person is unusually blessed, or if miraculous things are happening in his life and ministry, he's questioned. So that was the question. Who are you? Who are you? Look who's questioning. It ain't some reporter from the local TV station or the local newspaper. The priest and the Levites, the priestly tribe, they're the ones that are asking him, who are you? And they went on to say, you know, are you this prophet? Are you the Christ? But verse 20, he confessed and denied not. Isn't that something? As we talked about Sunday, Romans 1:16 says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God's salvation to him that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Gentile, or to the Greek. So he confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. Would it have been easy for him to? Yeah. Oh, I'm the Lord. I'm the Messiah's cousin, though. You can talk to me. I'll pass the word along. Here's your list. The lessons are clear. The servant, the minister, layman, whoever you want to call him, of God must not claim to be Christ, nor any other great prophet. We got to be humble. We can't pretend to be somebody great. We ought not seek recognition. One of the biggest blessings you'll ever have is to do something and don't let anybody know about it. You say, well, nobody will know who did it. Amen. Who'll get the praise? Hopefully God will. The servant of God must not assume honor that does not belong to him and must not allow God's power upon his life and ministry to turn his head toward pride, thinking more highly of himself than he should. Apostle Paul, who's probably the greatest preacher besides Jesus that ever walked the earth, 1 Corinthians 15:9, "For I am the least of the apostles, that I'm not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God." And as he wrote to Timothy in 1 Timothy 1:15, "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." So, he confessed. He didn't deny, but he confessed, "I am not the Christ." So they begin questioning him some more, peppering questions at him. Verse number 21. "Who are you then?" "Are you Elijah?" Now, interesting thing about Elijah, he didn't die. God took him. God's chariot came and took him. And if you remember, Elisha said that he wanted something. Elijah said, asked him so many words, "What do you want?" "I want a double portion of your blessing." And he said, "Well, if you see me taken up, you'll get it." So he had his eyes glued on him because he didn't want to miss that double blessing. How many blessings has Marty missed because he didn't have his eyes on Jesus where they needed to be? How many blessings have you missed because you didn't have your eyes where they needed to be? So, are you Elijah? God took him. Enoch, God took him. Moses, Bible says he died, but where's he buried at? A lot of folks believe the two witnesses in the book of Revelation are Elijah and Moses because of the things that those two witnesses are described as able to do. Of course, from God, they're able to give the plagues like Moses was the messenger to Pharaoh about through all that as the Israelites were, God was wanting them to release to worship him. And also, I believe it had some, they have the power to, about rain, which is one of the things I stands out in my life and me with me about the prophet Elijah, that he prayed in some three and a half years it didn't rain upon the face of the earth. So, you know, are we going through a little small drought now? Yeah. But it's not lasting 3 years, 3.5 years. So, are you Elijah? He saith, "I am not," verse 21. "Art thou that prophet?" No, I'm not him. That's not me. That is not me. Verse 22, they come back again. "Who are you? Who art thou? That we may give an answer to them that sent us, what sayest thou of thyself?" And again, I come back to that question I asked a while ago. What would we say? Job interview. Tell us about yourself. And usually at the end, it's, why should we choose you? Of all the applicants, why should we choose you? So that's basically what they're saying, interviewing him. Well, who are you then? You know, people back home are going to be asking who you are. What can we tell them? Verse 23, he says, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Turn over with me to Jeremiah chapter 1. Jeremiah chapter 1, and we'll start reading in verse number 4. So John the Baptist said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. How many times has the Lord directed us to be his voice? And because we might be the voice of one, we felt like we needed to hush. I like that. I am the voice of one. Jeremiah, the prophet, the weeping prophet. Verse 4 says, then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee not. Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Now, those that's in favor of abortion, Jeremiah 1:5. Sitting in, training union class, Sunday school class one morning. And they got to talking about the gray areas of the Bible, and I was like, really? Well, that ain't a gray area. Before he was even in the womb, he knew him. And before he came out of the womb, he was set aside for God's work. He had ordained him a prophet unto the nation. So what's Jeremiah going to do? Well, same thing Moses did, same thing I did, maybe same thing you did. Make excuses. Moses said, well, I can't talk. I'm not eloquent of speech. I can't talk. Take your brother Aaron with you. He can be your spokesman. I'll give it to you. You give it to Aaron. He can be your voice. What's Jeremiah saying? God says, I've called you. Before you was even conceived, I knew you. In verse 6, in all his wisdom, Jeremiah said, ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I'm a child. Verse 7 says, but the Lord said unto me, say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and said unto me, Behold, I put thy words, my words, in thy mouth. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out, to pull down, to destroy, to throw down, to build, to plant. So here's Jeremiah's job. Jeremiah, I want you to go get to be the prophet. Here's what I want you to say. I'm going to give you the words to say, but they ain't going to listen to you. But still you go. I appreciate what Isaiah 55, I believe it is, says. His word's going to go out and accomplish the things he wants it to. And there's Jeremiah proclaiming God's word to folks that had it go in one ear and out the other. Look down to Jeremiah 20 and verse 9. So Jeremiah goes out, gives them what God has said. They don't listen. He goes out, gives what God said. They don't listen. And here it comes to a point here, Jeremiah 20 and verse 9. Then I said, I will not make mention of him, nor speak any more in his name. That ain't the end of that verse, though. In other words, he just wants to go home. John the Baptist, what did he say? I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness. And speaking of Elijah, what did he think? He thought he was the only one, but he wasn't. So Jeremiah's been called, ordained, set aside by God, and he's going out proclaiming God's word, and then he comes to a point where he says, I ain't doing it no more. I quit. Now let's read the rest of that verse. But his word was in mine heart as a burning fire shut up in my bones, and I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay. You say, what does that mean? He kept proclaiming God's word. He thought about quitting. As a matter of fact, he said, I said in my heart, I'm not going to do it no more. But his word within me, as a burning fire shut up in my bones, I was weary from forbearing. In other words, keeping quiet wasn't good for him. As the saying says, the worm in hot ashes. And he says, I could not stay. So I think it says something about John the Baptist. Was he a different feller? Yeah. Did he live in a big city? No. Where was he at? He was in the wilderness. The voice of one crying in the wilderness. What was he doing? Make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah. Now, they that asked him these questions were Pharisees. And you say, well, remind us about the Pharisees. You've probably met some folks that were similar to Pharisees. I think my guineas that I had one time were Pharisee guineas. Because every one of them, I turned them out too early. I should have kept them up just a while longer because I turned them out. I think I got them right after they was hatched and turned them out too early. In the first rain, every one of them drowned because I'd let them out and every one of them's neck was turned up like that right there. And you say, well, what's that got to do with anything? They had their nose stuck up in the air where it didn't need to be. Water went right down their nostrils, killed them. Pharisees. That'd be a person who got their nose stuck up in the air. Thinks they're it. Pharisees thought they had the law of Moses as it was purely given to him, and that they had every I dotted, every T crossed, and they were the tops. You look at the ministry of Jesus as we went through Matthew, we went through Mark, we went through Luke, and now we're going through John. Who was his biggest critics? The Pharisees. And if they didn't come theirself, they sent somebody else some of the time. So the Pharisees here, beginning of John, here right before Jesus' ministry started, was questioning John, who are you? When they asked us who you are, who we're going to say? And so he told them that he was the one voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said. In verse 25, they asked him a question. Why baptizest thou then? If you're not the Christ, if you're not the Messiah, why are you baptizing? And I think, kind of like the rich young ruler, you know, he came to Jesus and said, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus told him about the part of the Ten Commandments that deals with man's relationship with man. Oh, he was a good feller. A good feller. Matter of fact, when Jesus got done telling him that part, he said, well, hey, I've kept them since I was a youth up. And then Jesus wouldn't finish. One thing you lack, sell what you got, give money to the poor, and take up your cross and follow me. And the Bible says he hung his head and walked off because his trust was in riches. So who are you? If when they asked us who you are, what could we say? I'm the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord. Why baptize you if you're not him? If you're not him, if you're not Elijah, if you're not neither that prophet, why? And here's what he said. John answered in verse 26, them saying, I baptize with water. But there standeth one among you whom you know not. In verse 11, Apostle John, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, had told us, he came into his own received him not. And John the Baptist is saying, there's one coming after me. He's amongst you. He it is, in verse 27, who cometh after me, he's preferred before me, whose shoes latch it. I am not worthy to unloose. So he was beyond Jordan, Bethabara, where John was baptizing, and verse 29, and we might get down through verse 34. When I get to verse 29, I always like to tell this story. One of the early evangelists in America that was building a big tabernacle, a big chapel, a big church for him to preach in, because I reckon where they was having huge crowds. So they had built, and they brought him in there to put the lectern, put the podium where it needed to be. They didn't have these. Didn't have this. So they had built it where the acoustics were just great, and they wanted to get that position. So he got the lectern. He set it somewhere. Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. And it just echoed through the building. I said, that's good. Move it a little bit. And so he moved it. Did that about two or three times. and finally got it where it needed to be. Years later, he gets a message that somebody at the hospital on their deathbed had called for him. And so he went in, and he didn't recognize the guy. But the guy knew exactly who he was. He said, I need to tell you something. He said, I was a construction worker. I helped build your church. I didn't think nobody was in there, and you didn't know I was in there, but I was in the balcony laying flat on my back doing whatever he was doing, and all of a sudden I heard this voice, "Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." And he said, I got to looking around where that voice was coming from, and I heard it two or three more times, and it shook me up so much, I realized my lostness. And I was saved, and I found out that voice come from you. And I just wanted to tell you that before I left here. God's word is so powerful. You know, we go to the store, and everything's went up, right? We were talking, I don't know if it was I think it was some people at work talking about how much fast food had doubled or tripled in cost just in the last little while. Salvation is free because it's done been paid for. So John saw him coming. Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. So we'll talk a little bit more about verse 29 next time, and we'll stop there. Any word from anybody before we dismiss tonight? So what a man John the Baptist was. You said, well, he had his doubts. You read Jesus, what Jesus said about him. There hath no man, greater man, been born among women than John the Baptist. So I'll take Jesus testifying about him. Did he have his doubts? Yep. But I'm going to take Jesus' testimony. Anything before we close tonight? All right, well, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your many, many blessings. Thank you for allowing us to be gathered as we are tonight. Lord, we're thankful, Lord, for the praise reports we give tonight. And Lord, we're thankful for being able just to approach your throne of grace on behalf of these folks. Probably others, Lord, on our heart that we didn't mention. Lord, you go with us as we go our separate ways tonight and return us again to worship you again. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for being.